And so I say to all of you here and to all in the nation tonight that those who appeal to you to hold on to the past do so at the cost of denying you your future. This great, rich, restless country can offer opportunity and education and hope to all black and white, all north and south. Sharecropper and city dweller, these are the enemies. Poverty, ignorance, disease, they are enemies, not our fellow man, not our neighbor. And these enemies too, poverty, disease, and ignorance, we shall overcome.
If you are fighting for the rights of man, you never be from fear. I never know when they're going to pass here and blow this house to bits. We still get threatening telephone calls, the hate mail. But nevertheless, I feel if I'm going to live in this town and live with myself, I must oppose hatred and prejudice in any way that I can.
She was not soft-spoken. She was not humble. She didn't ask. She told. It just blew people's minds. Who is this woman sounding like this? Who does she think she is?
Daisy Bates was willing to suffer the consequences of her action. And when you've been at war, you know that there's a price. She was the one soldier that was willing to put her life on the battlefield for those children.
Motivated by the violence of her own mother's rape and murder, and determined to make a change in the way America viewed race, Daisy Gatson Bates became a revolutionary civil rights activist and leader, making a significant difference in our state. Daisy grew up in the small town of Huttig, Arkansas. She was adopted by Oralee and Susie Smith when she was just 7 years old, after her mother's rape and murder by three men. Those men were never prosecuted, and this sparked a fire in Daisy that filled her with hate. Her father gave her some advice that would later encourage her to be a leader for change. He said, "Hate can destroy you, Daisy. If you hate, make it count for something. Try to do something about it, or your hate won't spell a thing." Her first chance to do something was in 1941, when she and her husband, Elsie Bates, started their own newspaper called the Arkansas State Press. The paper centered around equal rights for all and became a voice for the African American community. Her influence on the equal rights movement earned her the title of president of the NAACP in 1952. It was during that time that Daisy put her focus on fighting for the same quality of education for all races.
Daisy Bates!
When the desegregation crisis of Central High School occurred in 1957, Daisy's dedication to education made her the driving force behind the cause. She guided and advised the nine students chosen to attend the all-white high school. She used her home as the meeting place for the Little Rock Nine, planning and implementing how desegregation would be carried out. She became president of the parent-teacher organization even though she did not have a child enrolled at the school. She knew she was an advocate for those nine students, and she knew that her fight was not just for them, but for the entire African-American race. Even though her home was often a target for those who were against desegregation, she never lost sight of her dream for equality, making her a pivotal figure in the civil rights movement and a fearless heroine of our state.
By 1957, Arkansas Governor Orville Faubus was showing no sign of making good on his state's promise of gradual integration. Their proposed plan, known as the Blossom Plan, after school superintendent Virgil Blossom, was to integrate slowly, starting with Little Rock Central High School. Daisy Bates, president of the Arkansas NAACP, saw the Blossom Plan as a stalling tactic used to weaken desegregation. And in 1956, the NAACP filed a lawsuit to speed the integration. In the 2 years that followed, Little Rock became a city in crisis. On one side of the conflict sat Orville Favas and his racist Southern Democratic constituency. On the other, Daisy Bates and the NAACP. And directly in the middle, nine African-American students whose actions of bravery would set in motion a chain of geopolitical transformations in the U.S. that continues still today. Melba Petillo Beals, Minnie Jean Brown, Elizabeth Eckford, Ernest Green, Gloria Ray Kallmark, Carlotta Walls Lanier, Thelma Mothershed, Terrence Roberts, and Jefferson Thomas. These were the nine exemplary students chosen by Daisy Bates and the NAACP to force Faba's hand in following the mandates of the federal government. In a radical effort to stop the students from entering the school, Governor Faba's deployed the Arkansas National Guard to blockade the entrance. The image of soldiers standing face to face with nine defenseless high school students shocked the country. 20 days later, on September 24, 1957, President Dwight D. Eisenhower ordered the 101st Airborne Division to Little Rock to escort the students, and then federalized the Arkansas National Guard out of Faba's control.
On September 24, 1957, President Dwight D. Eisenhower flew from Rhode Island to Washington, D.C. to address the nation about violent resistance to nine African-American students attempting to integrate Central High School in Little Rock, Arkansas. This is the president's 13-minute address where he announced he was sending federal troops to ensure the student safety.
From the President's office in the White House in Washington, D.C., we present a special address by the President of the United States, Dwight D. Eisenhower. Mr. Eisenhower discusses the integration problem at Little Rock, Arkansas. Ladies and gentlemen, the President of the United States.
Good evening, my fellow citizens. For a few minutes this evening, I should like to speak to you about the serious situation that has arisen in Little Rock. To make this talk, I have come to the President's office in the White House. I could have spoken from Rhode Island, or where I have been staying recently, but I felt that, in speaking from the House of Lincoln, of Jackson, and of Wilson, my words would better convey both the sadness I feel in the action I was compelled today to make, and the firmness with which I intend to pursue this course until the orders of the federal court at Little Rock can be executed without unlawful interference. In that city, under the leadership of demagogic extremists, disorderly mobs have deliberately prevented the carrying out of proper orders from a federal court. Local authorities have not eliminated that violent opposition. And under the law, I yesterday issued a proclamation calling upon the mob to disperse. This morning, the mob again gathered in front of the Central High School of Little Rock, obviously for the purpose of again preventing the carrying out of the court's order relating to the admission of Negro children to that school. Whenever normal agencies prove inadequate to the task, and it becomes necessary for the executive branch of the federal government to use its powers and authority to uphold federal courts, the president's responsibility is inescapable. In accordance with that responsibility, I have today issued an executive order directing the use of troops under federal authority to aid in the execution of federal law at Little Rock, Arkansas. This became necessary when my proclamation of yesterday was not observed, and the obstruction of justice still continues. It is important that the reasons for my action be understood by all our citizens. As you know, the Supreme Court of the United States has decided that separate public educational facilities for the races are inherently unequal, and therefore compulsory school segregation laws are unconstitutional. Our personal opinions about the decision have no bearing on the matter of enforcement. The responsibility and authority of the Supreme Court to interpret the Constitution are very clear. local federal courts were instructed by the Supreme Court to issue such orders and decrees as might be necessary to achieve admission to public schools without regard to race and with all deliberate speed. During the past several years, many communities in our southern states have instituted public school plans for gradual progress in the enrollment and attendance of school children of all races in order to bring themselves into compliance with the law of the land. Thus, they demonstrated to the world that we are a nation in which laws, not men, are supreme. I regret to say that this truth, the cornerstone of our liberties, was not observed in this instance. It was my hope that this localized situation would be brought under control by city and state authorities. If the use of local police powers had been sufficient, our traditional method of leaving the problem in those hands would have been pursued. But when large gatherings of obstructionists made it impossible for the decrees of the court to be carried out, both the law and the national interest demanded that the president take action. Here is the sequence of events in the development of the Little Rock School case. In May of 1955, the Little Rock School Board approved a moderate plan for the gradual desegregation of the public schools in that city. It provided that a start toward integration would be made at the present term in the high school, and that the plan would be in full operation by 1963. Here I might say that in a number of communities in Arkansas, integration in the schools has already started and without violence of any kind. Now, this Little Rock plan was challenged in the courts by some who believed that the period of time as proposed in the plan was too long. The United States Court at Little Rock, which has supervisory responsibility under the law for the plan of desegregation in the public schools, dismissed the challenge, thus approving a gradual rather than an abrupt change from the existing system. The court found that the school board had acted in good faith in planning for a public school system free from racial discrimination. Since that time, the court has on three separate occasions issued orders directing that the plan be carried out. All persons were instructed to refrain from interfering with the efforts of the school board to comply with the law. Proper and sensible observance of the law then demanded the respectful obedience which the nation has a right to expect from all its people. This, unfortunately, has not been the case at Little Rock. Certain misguided persons, many of them imported into Little Rock by agitators, have insisted upon defying the law and have sought to bring it into disrepute. The orders of the court have thus been frustrated. The very basis of our individual rights and freedoms rests upon the certainty that the president and the executive branch of government will support and ensure the carrying out of the decisions of the federal courts, even when necessary, with all the means at the president's command. Unless the president did so, anarchy would result. There would be no security for any except that which each one of us could provide for himself. The interest of the nation in the proper fulfillment of the law's requirements cannot yield to opposition and demonstrations by some few persons. Mob rule cannot be allowed to override the decisions of our courts. Now let me make it very clear that federal troops are not being used to relieve local and state authorities of their primary duty to preserve the peace and order of the community. Nor are the troops there for the purpose of taking over the responsibility of the school board and other responsible local officials in running Central High School. The running of our school system and the maintenance of peace and order in each of our states are strictly local affairs, and the federal government does not interfere, except in very special cases and when requested by one of the several states. In the present case, the troops are there pursuant to law solely for the purpose of preventing interference with the orders of the court. The proper use of the powers of the executive branch to enforce the orders of a federal court is limited to extraordinary and compelling circumstances. Manifestly, such an extreme situation has been created in Little Rock. This challenge must be met, and with such measures as will preserve to the people as a whole their lawfully protected rights in a climate permitting their free and fair exercise. The overwhelming majority of our people in every section of the country are united in their respect for observance of the law, even in those cases where they may disagree with that law. They deplore the call of extremists to violence. The decision of the Supreme Court concerning school integration, of course, affects the South more seriously than it does other sections of the country. In that region, I have many warm friends, some of them in the city of Little Rock. I have deemed it a great personal privilege to spend in our Southland tours of duty while in the military service and enjoyable recreational periods since that time. So from intimate personal knowledge, I know that the overwhelming majority of the people in the South, including those of Arkansas and of Little Rock, are of goodwill, united in their efforts to preserve and respect the law, even when they disagree with it. They do not sympathize with mob rule. They, like the rest of our nation, have proved in two great wars their readiness to sacrifice for America. And the foundation of the American way of life is our national respect for law. In the South, as elsewhere, citizens are keenly aware of the tremendous disservice that has been done to the people of Arkansas in the eyes of the nation, and that has been done to the nation in the eyes of the world. At a time when we face grave situations abroad because of the hatred that communism bears toward a system of government based on human rights, it would be difficult to exaggerate the harm that is being done to the prestige and influence, and indeed to the safety of our nation and the world. Our enemies are gloating over this incident and using it everywhere to misrepresent our whole nation. We are portrayed as a violator of those standards of conduct which the peoples of the world united to proclaim in the Charter of the United Nations. There they affirm faith in fundamental human rights and in the dignity and worth of the human person. And they did so without distinction as to race, sex, language, or religion. And so, with deep confidence, I call upon the citizens of the state of Arkansas to assist in bringing to an immediate end all interference with the law and its processes. If resistance to the federal court order ceases at once, the further presence of federal troops will be unnecessary, and the city of Little Rock will return to its normal habits of peace and order, and a blot upon the fair name and high honor of our nation in the world will be removed. Thus will be restored the image of America and of all its parts as one nation, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Good night, and thank you very much.
The long, treacherous walk of the Little Rock Nine ultimately ended in a victory for the NAACP, the integrity of the U.S. Constitution, and black students throughout the South that for all of American history had been subjected to deplorable limitations in their pursuit of education. The legacy of their resolve has been immortalized in the mythos of American history, but their walk hasn't ended. In 1999, while presenting each of the Little Rock Nine with the Congressional Medal of Honor, President Bill Clinton issued a warning. Segregation is no longer the law, but too often separation is still the rule. Today, children of every race walk through the same door, but then they often walk down different halls. They sit in different classrooms. They eat at different tables. They even sit in different parts of the bleachers at the football game. Though Phobos is gone, his vile notions of inequity persist in our education system still today. It is the role of the current generation to continue the walk of the Little Rock Nine, to shoulder that same cross boldly through the Valley of Shadows, and to stop only when sunlight has illuminated every ridge, cleansed every cavern, and the rivers of knowledge flow generously to every child that pursues them.
We should not be forcibly integrated or forcibly anything, and we do have a right to say we do not like it.
It was here at Little Rock Central High where nine students galvanized the American Civil Rights Movement.
In a constant state of power.
Most remarkably, it was all orchestrated by one person.
You know who I mean, Daisy Bates.
Here is Daisy Bates not being an assistant, but being the leader.
At a time when women were expected to be silent, she was unafraid to speak the truth.
She was the one soldier that was willing to put her life on the battlefield for those children.
In a place where injustice was enforced by fear, she would not compromise.
So I feel if I'm going to live in this town and live with myself, I must oppose hatred and prejudice.
Pioneer, leader, citizen. Daisy Bates, First Lady of Little Rock.
You're listening to Electrifying Mojo, Rare Moments. If you like this video, hit the like button. If you wish to subscribe, hit the subscription button. If you like this video, hit the like button. If you wish to subscribe, hit the subscription button. If you wish to subscribe, hit the subscription button. Hit the subscription button. Do not ever leave home without your mask. Do not ever cook food for you or anyone else without your mask. Do not serve food without your mask. Do not talk to anyone without your mask. And that's 6 feet away. The 6 foot distancing from another person is not a substitute for wearing your mask. It's plus wearing your mask. What are the consequences of not staying 6 feet apart? It could be a decision to stay 6 feet apart or being 6 feet under. The safest place for you is at home. If you must leave home, keep a 6 foot distance from whomever you encounter. Wash your hands constantly. Do not touch your face. Wear disposable gloves wherever you go. Dispose of those gloves once you're back in your safe location. Good friends keep good friends.